Good morning, guys. What's up? So once again, I am here with you people. And now you might be very clear, right? I would have got a lot of questions for you, right? And yes, you are right. So as per you can see on the board, I have collected at around 10 questions once again, which are typically based on the NEET pattern. So this is NEET pattern exercise. First time we are going to do this NEET pattern exercise for the chapter atomic structure. Okay, so guys, from the set of these 10 questions, I have taken around 6 questions which have been asked in past year NEET papers. Okay, 2 questions I have taken which have been asked in other medical competitive examinations, and the remaining 2 questions I have taken which are such like, you know, they are quite probable to be asked in exam for the upcoming years. Fine. So with this collection, now I think we should be starting with the very first question. Let me see what is there in store for us for the very first question. And the question is, the energy of electron is found to be maximum at whether the energy of the electron is maximum at the nucleus, at the ground state, at the first excited state, or at the infinite distance from the nucleus. So that's a question. Okay, now let us try to go to the crux of the question. The question is what? You need to calculate the energy of the electron. There is no need for the complete theoretical calculation. You don't have to derive any formula. It's just that you have to conceptually tell if there is an electron which is present around the nucleus, when the electron should be having the maximum energy. Okay, so to move on to the solution of this particular question, guys, do you remember we have discussed one theory part that the electron is negatively charged particle? Am I right? So we know, right, that the electron is a negatively charged particle, whereas the nucleus is positively charged, right? So there must be a kind of, you can say, attractive force. So there must be a kind of attractive force between the nucleus and the electron. So if you are talking between the nucleus and electron, there must be some attractive force that is present between the nucleus and the electron, right? Now if I continue further, do you agree if I say that when the electron will be at infinite distance from the nucleus? So let us say the fourth point, when electron will be at infinite distance from the nucleus, that means the electron is here, nucleus is here, and they cannot even see each other. So when they cannot even see each other, there will be no force between them. So the force of attraction or the force of repulsion will be zero. So when the electron will be at infinite distance from the nucleus, there won't be any interactions. So see, I have written, there won't be any interactions. Clear enough? Now see, I can further say that when electron comes closer to the nucleus, when electron comes closer to the nucleus, you can say the electron is attracted towards the nucleus. So you can say the force of attraction will become more and more. And the final attractive force will be given as, or the final, you cannot, so let me not say the final attractive force, I'll say the final energy of the electron will be minus 13.6 electron volt, right? That means, so if this is the nucleus, So the when electron is here, its energy is minus 13.6. It is going away, 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 away. A point will come when the energy becomes zero. Right? Now, you go more than infinity, then also energy will be zero, because infinity is something which you can't define. Now, he is saying the energy of the electron will be maximum at, it is not maximum at nucleus. It is a negative value, right? It is not maximum in the ground state. See guys, at the nucleus, the electron can never be there. So, if this is a nucleus, electron can never be found here. No. If this is a nucleus, electron will be found somewhere here at some distance from the nucleus, right? Where its energy will be minus 13.6 electron volt. So, even this is not the correct answer. Not the first excited state. I said the first excited state will be something like, again, minus 13.6 divided by 2 square, minus 13.6 divided by 3 square, and so on, right? But the maximum energy of the electron will be at infinite distance from the nucleus, and hence option number 1 will be the correct option for this question. Fine enough? Okay. So see, the question was quite good. Not an easy, I'll say, but quite a nice question. Having done with this, let us now move on to the second question. So you may note down whatever is there on the board if you need. By the time I will prepare the board for the second question. Let's see what is there as second question. And the question says that the longest wavelength of helium positive in the passion series. So, which series I am talking about? Guys, see, you remember the series, no? Lyman, Balmer, passion, Brackett, and Fun series, right? And in all these, N1 is equal to 1, N1 is 2, N1 is 3. So, N2 can be 4, 5, 6, and so on. So, we need only this particular thing. We do not need the knowledge about Lyman and passion. So, Lyman, Balmer, we don't need. Okay. Now, let me start writing down. He is saying that the longest wavelength of helium positive. Helium positive is having just one electron. One electron species with atomic number equal to 2. And he is talking about the longest wavelength. Guys, see, you know, right? E is equal to h nu, which is equal to hc over lambda. So, if energy will be more, lambda will be less. If lambda is more, energy is less, right? So, if he is talking about longest wavelength, I mean to say he is talking about minimum energy. Minimum energy is given as m. Okay? Now, see carefully, if he is talking about minimum energy transition, and the values which are given to me are 3, N1 is 3 starting from, so 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 and so on, right? So, the minimum energy transition will be, don't you think, 4 to 3? So, if the electron is coming from 4 to 3, it's of minimum energy. So, the transition will be N1 is equal to 3 to N2 is equal to 4. Okay? Now, let us try to use the Rydberg's equation for this particular concept which is given to me. So, can I use nu bar as 1 by lambda, which is Rh into Z square, where Rh is Rydberg's constant and Z is the atomic number. Then, we will write 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square. Okay? Moving further, what should I say? So, 1 by m is equal to Rh into 2 square is 4. Then 1 by n1 square is 9 minus 1 by n2 square, which is 16. Okay. So, now we'll get 1 by m is equal to Rh into 4, 16 into 9, 16 minus 9 is 7. So we get something this, and this is 4. So we get 1 by m is equal to 7RH divided by 36. Equation number 1 that I have got. Right? Now let us read the question again. You need to figure out the shortest wavelength. Come on to here. I'm going to talk about shortest wavelength. So shortest wavelength, let's say, is lambda dash. Okay? Now shortest wavelength, you do agree, means maximum energy. Okay, of which transition, and transition is taking place in what? So you can say shortest wavelength of beryllium 3 positive in Paschen series. So we are having beryllium 3 positive, again one electron species, but beryllium atomic number is 4. Again, you are talking about Paschen series. Now see, in the case of Paschen series, the longest wavelength will be, so see, long, longer, longer, longer. So when you move to, let's say, infinity, which you won't be able to see. So from infinity, if you are coming on to 3, you can say that is the longest wavelength. So that is the, let us say, maximum energy but smallest wavelength. Yeah, I am correcting myself. So the energy is maximum from infinity to 3, whereas the wavelength will be minimum. So maximum energy transition will be from n1 is equal to 3 to n2 is equal to infinity. Okay, so let us apply the same formula here. I will say nu bar is 1 by lambda dash is equal to RH into Z square again, 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square, right? So, let us erase the things which we don't need. We don't need this section of the board. So, let me just erase this. Yeah, I don't need this much. So, let us try to solve that. So, we will be getting 1 by lambda dash is equal to RH into atomic number for beryllium. So we have hydrogen, helium, lithium, beryllium. 4. So 4 into 4, 16. Into 1 by N1 square. For Paschen series, N1 is 3. So 1 by 9 minus 1 by N2 square, infinity square. You do agree, right? Infinity square is another infinity. And we also know 1 by infinity is nothing but 0. So this is gone. So we will get 1 by lambda dash is equal to 16 by 9 times RH. Right? So if I want to calculate lambda dash, it will be 9 by 16 RH. Now let us do something so as to put the value of RH from here. So what is the RH? 36 by 7m. Is equal to RH. Try to substitute the value here. So we'll get lambda dash is equal to 9 by 16 into 36 by 7 m. Fine? So see, so lambda dash is equal to 9 by 16 into RH. RH will be 36 to be divided by 7 m. So this will be the final answer. So see, 9, 4. So 7 by 16 into 4, 64. So this is 7m by 64. Let's try to figure out the answer. 5 by 36. No guys, 64 by 7 is not the answer. So 7m by 64. Okay. So I'll say option number D is the correct option for this particular question. Fine. But guys, questions of this type are really very important both for the NEET pattern as well as for the CBSE pattern question. So please make sure that you are revising other questions of this type as well. Okay, having done till this much, let us now move on to the next question. So moving on to the next question, let me make you read the question. You read the question by the time I'll prepare the board for you. try to see what is there in the question. He's saying there are three energy levels, P, Q and R. Okay, and they are of a certain atom. They are such that the energy of P is less than energy of Q, which is less than energy of R. So I just draw the three energy levels, P, Q, R. But he is saying energy of P is less than Q than R. So let us say this is the order of energy. Okay. Now moving further, so till here we are done. Moving further, he says, if lambda 1, lambda 2 and lambda 3 are the wavelengths of the radiation which correspond to the transition. So if something is coming from R to Q, then the wavelength is lambda 1. If something is coming from Q to P, then the wavelength is lambda 2. And if something is coming from R to P, so the wavelength is lambda 3. You need to tell the correct relationship between lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3. See guys, so first of all I'll write R to Q is lambda 1. So if electron is transiting between R to Q, the wavelength is of the order lambda 1. Okay. Then we'll say Q to P is lambda 2. So Q to P is lambda 2. And the third is R to P directly, and that is lambda 3. Fine. Now see, many of the students, they will do this mistake that, ma'am, lambda 1 plus lambda 2 is lambda 3. What? Energy. This is the difference of wavelengths or what? These are what? These are the energy levels. See, I have typically written energy level. So this energy plus this energy can give a total of this energy, right? Not this wavelength plus this wavelength can give the total of this wavelength. So don't say that lambda 1 plus lambda 2 is equal to lambda 3, right? We know that they can be written as a sum of energies. So can I simply say energy from R to Q plus energy from Q to P can be taken equal to energy from R to P. This is a better option, right? So the energy, if the electron is coming from here to here and spends, let's say, 20 joules, here to here spends 10 joules more. So if he is coming directly from here to here, it will spend 30 joules, right? Now see, do you know that we can write E is equal to H nu, which is HC by lambda, right? So see, can I start writing down? H into C by lambda for R to Q plus H into C by lambda for Q to P is equal to H into C by lambda R to P. Right? Now see, HC, HC, HC got cancelled. So can I simply say 1 by lambda R to Q? So R to Q is lambda 1 plus 1 by lambda Q to P is lambda 2 is equal to 1 by lambda R to P is lambda 3. So we can simply get 1 by lambda 1 plus 1 by lambda 2 is equal to 1 by lambda 3. See if there is any particular equation like this. So we have 1 by lambda 3 is equal to 1 by lambda 1 plus lambda 2. Not this, not this. So I'll say option number B is the correct option for this question as well. So we have 1 by lambda 3 is equal to 1 by lambda 1 plus 1 by lambda 2. That's correct. Fine. So having done this particular question, let us now quickly move on to question number 4. Chill out for a minute. By the time I'll erase the things on board, then we can continue. Okay, let me move on to reading the fourth question for you. And the question says, the energy of an electron is given by this. So there is an electron whose energy is given by the equation 2.178 to be multiplied by 10 raised to the power minus 18, okay, into Z square divided by N square joules. Okay, so this is the energy of electron. With Z must be the atomic number of the atom it belongs to, and N must be the orbit. Energy of electron in nth orbit. Okay. Now moving further, he says, the wavelength of the light which is required to excite an electron in a hydrogen atom. So there is, you are talking about hydrogen atom. So if the electron is in hydrogen atom, so I can simply remove this Z and I will write 1 here. Okay, and in order to simplify it, I'll just write it like this. So the wavelength of the light, so we need to calculate wavelength of light, which is required if you want to excite an electron in an hydrogen atom from level N1 to N2 will be. So what wavelength of light is to be provided if the electron is to be excited from two energy levels, N1 is equal to 1 to N2 is equal to 2. So guys, don't you think I should find the energy of first orbit? I should find the energy of second orbit. So whatever is the difference in energy, that is delta E, can be correlated to the energy of the wavelength, which is H nu, which is HC by lambda. Okay, so let us now continue. So we can find the energy in first orbit will be 2.178 into 10 raised to the power minus 18 into 1 by 1 square joules. Fine. Now what should be the energy of electron in second orbit? So this is 2.178 into 10 raised to the power minus 18 into 1 by 2 square joules. Am I right? So try to correlate with the difference in energy. So you will say, ma'am, delta E, which can be written as E2 minus E1, is equal to 2.178 into 10 raised to the power minus 18, 1 by 4 minus 1 by 1. So this is 1 by 4 minus 1 by 1. Fine. Or guys, I am just asking you to take the magnitude. So you can also do E1 minus E2 or E2 minus E1, but you need to take the magnitude. Okay. So now if you solve it, you will finally get delta E is equal to 2.178 into 10 raised to the power minus 18 into 1 minus 4 is 3 by 4 joules. So this is the magnitude of energy I have taken. Fine. Now moving further. See, can I now simply say that the difference in the energy will be equal to the energy of the radiation which is needed. So we know this difference is equal to energy of radiation, which is H nu, which is HC by lambda. So we can say delta E is equal to HC by lambda, or lambda is equal to H into C by delta E. This is okay. Now if I'm asking you to substitute the value, so on substitution, substituting the values will get 6.636 into 10 raised to the power minus 34 joule seconds, right? To be multiplied by 3 into 10 raised to the power 8 meters per second. So see, second inverse and second got cancelled, right? Now we have 2.178 into 10 raised to the power minus 18 into 3 divided by 4 joules. So joules and joules will get cancelled, okay? And if you finally solve it, you will finally get the answer as 1.12, so 1.214. So the final answer that you will get is 1.214 into 10 raised to the power minus 7 meters, which is coming to be same as option number D. Okay? So, I am a calculator. See, I can solve everything in one go. But you are not. So, use the calculator or maybe you can use the approximations in order to finally solve it and get this as the answer. Okay? Let us now move on to one another question, which is question number 5. So let's see what is being said in question number 5. So question number 5 says that the electron which is identified by quantum numbers n and l, these four values are given, can be placed in the order of increasing energy as. So you just need to tell the order of increasing energies of A, B, C, D. Fine? Now see, first is, you know, right? The energy of the electron is simply given. It is not given whether it is one electron system or more. So you just need to use the rule, which is n plus l rule for energy of electron. So in order to tell the energy of electron, we use the n plus l rule, right? Moving on to the first option. So, where n is equal to 4, l is equal to 1. So, what should be the value of n plus l? 5, right? Moving on to the next case, n is equal to 4, l is equal to 0. So, 4 plus 0 is 4. So, now we will say, this is final answer 4, right? So, first of all, I am very much clear that the energy of A will be found to be greater than energy of B. So, let us ignore the options if they are there. So, he is saying A greater than B may be correct. A less than B, not at all possible. A greater than B, A greater than B. So, only B cannot be the answer. Otherwise, A, C, D can be the answer. Moving on to the third part, which says N is 3, L is 2. So, N plus L will be 3 plus 2, which is 5, right? So now, ma'am, this is also same, this is also same. So one was n is equal to 4, another was n is equal to 3. You remember, right? If two electrons are having the same value of n plus l, then the electron which is having a lower value of n will be lower in energy. So I will say B is genuinely smaller. Then this is N4, so it will be maximum. Then it will be C. Okay, so A is greater than C, greater than B. So let us see. He is saying C is greater than A, but I said A is greater than C. Even this can't be the option. He is saying A is greater than B and B is greater than C, which is wrong. What I got? A greater than C, greater than B, and this must be okay. I'm not checking about D because I checked all the three options. Okay, so either you could have done all the four, get your sequence or the series and check it here, or you did three of them and check all the four options. So one and the same thing. So finally, we can say option number D will be the correct option for this particular question. Note it down, guys, so that we can continue further to the next question of the series. So guys, done with the fifth question. Let us now quickly move on to our next question, which is question number 6. Just give me a minute. So what's there in question number 6? So the question number 6 simply says, the radius of which of the following orbit is same as the radius of which of the following ABCD is same as that of the first Bohr's orbit of hydrogen atom. You know, right, that the radius of first Bohr orbit of hydrogen atom is nothing but R0, which is said to be A0, which is 0.529 angstroms, right? So, we simply need to calculate the radius of all four of them and see which matches as the value 0.529. Okay? So, now guys, you know the relationship between the radius of any atom is given as, in the nth orbit, is given as R0 into. Now see, for energy, Z will be there in numerator, and for radius, N will be there. So we have Rn is equal to R0 into N square divided by Z. Okay, let us start doing all the options. The first is helium 2 plus with N is equal to 2. And if it is helium, you know the value of Z will be 2, right? So can I say radius of helium 2 positive will be R0 into, what is the value of N square? So N square is 2 into 2, 4 by 2, which is 2 R0. No, we want the answer to be R0. Let us move on to second part, which says lithium 2 plus with the second orbit. So again, radius of lithium 2 plus will be equal to R0 into N square, 4 divided by atomic number 3. Again, this is not the answer, right? Moving on to the third case, which says lithium 2 plus N is equal to 3. Okay, so R of lithium 2 plus is equal to R0 into N square, which is 9 divided by Z, which is 3, which is 3 R0. Again, not required to us, not useful. Let's have our fingers crossed to see whether fourth option is right or not. Otherwise, we'll have to start the question all over again. So fourth is beryllium 3 plus and N is equal to 2. So N is 2 and you know that the Z value is 4. I am getting the intuition that this is going to be the correct answer. See, radius of beryllium 3 plus will be equal to R0 into N square, 2 into 2, 4 by 4. Hooray, I got the answer. Rb 3 plus is equal to R0. This is what we wanted. So I'll simply say that R of option number D is same as R1 hydrogen atom. Okay, so we'll say option number D is the correct option. You would have seen, right, so many questions are there with option number D. So never lose hope till C point that, oh, we didn't get the answer. So for D is always there, right? Okay, let us now move on to question number 7. So, if I am going to talk about question number 7, let us see what it is saying. It is saying the number of electrons which are present in cobalt 2 plus having azimuthal quantum number L is equal to 1. So, I want the azimuthal quantum number L is equal to 1. Guys, tell me one thing. When N value is equal to N, right? L value will be 0, 1, 2, up to N minus 1, right? You know, right? If L is 0, it is S orbital, L is 1, P orbital, L is 2, D orbital and so on. So, he is simply saying to calculate the number of electrons which are present in cobalt 2 plus. Having azimuthal quantum number L is equal to 1 means the electrons which are lying in P orbital. So, you need to talk about the electrons which belong to P orbital. So, first of all, let us write the atomic number of cobalt, which is 27. Write down the electronic configuration. 1s2, 2s2, 2p6. 3s2, 3p6, 4s2, 3d7. See? So, 10 plus 10, 20. Plus 7, 27, right? Now see, when I want to make the cation, first of all, I'll arrange the orbitals in the order of collection. So, one orbital belonging to N is equal to 1 will be written together. Orbital belonging to N is equal to 2 will be written together. Orbitals belonging to N is equal to 3 will be all together written together. And then coming the orbitals with n is equal to 4. Okay. Now, since you need to make cobalt 2 plus, I want to remove 2 electrons. So, now start removing the electrons from the outermost energy level. Okay. So, finally, you will say cobalt 2 plus will be 1s2, 2s2, 2p6. So, after 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, we will have 3s2, 3p6, and then we have 3d7. Don't get confused. He simply asked you to tell the total number of electrons in p orbital. 6 plus 6, making it 12. See, if there is an option 12. Oh my God, it's again option number D. So, it's a lucky paper. Every time I'm getting B as the option. Right? Okay. So, this was our question number 7th. Now, let us move on to the next question. Take a deep breath before I present the next question for you. Let me clear the board. You take a deep breath and do that yoga or whatever you do in 1 minute, right? Okay. So, question number 8 now says, the orbit angular momentum, it should be maybe orbit or orbital angular momentum of an electron in 2s orbital. Guys, yes, it should be orbital angular momentum. So, the orbital angular momentum, you remember, right? It is given by the formula h over 2 pi under root l into l plus 1, where L is the azimuthal quantum number. Am I right? So, this will be H over 2 pi under root for an electron in 2s orbital. For 2s orbital, it is S. So, for S orbital, the value of L will be 0. So, h over 2 pi into under root 0, 0 plus 1. Guys, 0 into anything is 0, under root of 0 is 0. So, 0 multiplied by anything again 0. So, it is 0. And hence, oh, this time we again got option number B. It's not a lucky question because the answer is not D, right? By the way, still we got an answer. So, option number B is the correct option for question number 8. Having done with this, now moving on to the next question that we have. So, guys, we are now on the second last question. Only 2 questions for you are left, and then the session can be done properly. Now, the question number 9 states that an unknown particle. So, there is a particle. Let's say that is P. It's unknown, I don't know which particle it is there. Having double charge as the charge on a proton. So, first is proton. Let us say the mass of proton is M. So, mass of particle will be MP. Okay, so M, MP. Now, assume that the charge on proton is plus E. So, the charge on particle can be presumed to be plus 2e. Am I right? So, this is what is said to us in question. So, an unknown particle having double charge as proton moves with a wavelength lambda. So, this particle is moving with a wavelength lambda. If it is accelerated from rest through a potential difference of V by 8 volts. Okay. So, he is saying that although the particle was at rest, now you provided a potential difference and it started moving with a wavelength of lambda, and the potential difference that you have provided is V by 8 volts. Okay. So, now one thing is very clear in my mind that I have to use the formula lambda is equal to H over root 2 into m into v into v. For the derivation, you can refer to the theory lectures because I remember we have done this derivation there. while the proton itself moves with the same wavelength lambda, the proton is also moving with the same wavelength lambda when accelerated from rest through a potential difference of V volt. This time it has been accelerated through a potential difference of V volts. Okay, you need to tell which is that particular particle. And let us first look at the options. Helium plus. What is helium plus? Helium plus is having a total charge of Z is equal to, see, the protons are 2. Right? Then we have lithium 2 plus and the number of electron is 1. In lithium 2 plus the number of electron is 1, whereas the Z value is 3. Am I right? Next is helium 2 plus. Helium 2 plus is just a proton where the number of electron is 0 and Z value is 2. And the next is beryllium 2 plus. So beryllium 2 plus, again the Z value is 4, whereas electrons are 2. Okay, now see, let us move for the question. So can I simply say the lambda for a proton, which will be lambda, is equal to H, the Planck's constant, divided by under root 2 into m. So 2 is there, mass of proton is taken as m, fine, into charge on the proton is E and the wavelength of the proton is lambda. So into the voltage through which it has been accelerated is V. So this is equation number 1. Lambda is equal to H over root 2 MeV, which is exactly the same we have got from here. Okay, now moving on to the particle. So lambda for particle is again lambda. H for the particle is H over under root 2, right? So what is the mass of the particle? Mp. So mass of particle is Mp into what is the charge on the particle? The charge on the particle is 2E. And what is the potential difference through which it has been accelerated? V by 8. So just solve it like this into V divided by 8, right? Now we know that the lambda that we have got from equation number 1 and from equation number 2 are exactly the same. So when the two lambdas are same, let us simply put them equal to each other. So when I am putting them equal to each other, what should I be getting as the final option? I will get H over under root 2 M E V, right, is equal to H over, so see, under root 2 I am taking separately, under root MP I am taking separately, under root 2 into 1 by 8 I am taking separately, under root E into V I am taking separately, okay, so as to cut out maximum thing. So H and H will get cancelled, under root 2 will get cancelled, right? So on the left hand side what we will be getting? 1 by under root M, okay, E and E will get cancelled, V and V will get cancelled. So on the left hand side we will just get 1 by under root M, okay. And on the right hand side what we will be getting will be equal to 1 by under root MP, then to be multiplied by 1 by 4, so 1 by 4, am I right? Now see what will happen, let me just cut out these things, we don't need them anymore. So see, go very very slowly, very very carefully. So 1 by under root M, so I am asking you to take square on both the sides. So when you do the square on both the sides, you will get 1 by square root of M is M, which will be equal to 1 by mass of particle, 1 by under root MP square is 1 by MP, and this will be equal to 1 by 4, right, because under root of 1 by 4 is 1 by 4. So 1 by M is equal to 1 by MP 4. So we can say, so MP can be written as 4 times M. So the mass of particle will be 4 times the mass of the proton, right? So see, For helium 2 plus, for helium plus, I am saying the total mass will be, now see, Z is equal to 4 if I'll say. The mass of the particle has to be found. What should I write? Let's see. Now I am simply saying that the mass of the particle, so I am simply saying that the mass of particle will be found to be 4 times the mass of a proton. Fine? 4 times the mass of proton. Let's see, what was helium plus? Helium plus is having 2 protons, 1 electron and 2 neutrons. So the mass is not just 4 times, right? Mass of electron is also there. Now for lithium plus, if I say, lithium is atomic number 3. So 2 comma 1. So lithium plus is having how many protons? 3. How many electrons? 2. How many neutrons? Again 3. So not the same as 4 times. Helium 2 plus. Helium 2 plus is what? Helium is atomic number 2. So hydrogen, helium. Atomic number 2 means protons will be 2, electrons will be 2, neutrons will be 2. Right? I am just saying helium 2 plus. That means no electrons are there. So 2 protons, 2 neutrons. Don't you think making it a total of 4? Right? Which is same as the mass of 4 particles. Okay? So it is 4 times the mass of 1 proton, and hence I'll say option number C is the correct option for this particular question, because no electron was there. Okay, so having done with this, let us finally move on to the last question of the exercise, and let's see what is the last question. Now the question says the number of nodal planes in a px orbital. You know, right, what is a nodal plane? So nodal plane is a plane which passes through the nucleus. Plane passing through the nucleus, where the probability to find the electron is 0. For a px orbital, can I draw it like this? X, Y, Z. See, if I'm talking about a px orbital, it must be lying along x-axis. So we have electron density being found here. We have electron density being found here, right? Now, do you think I can draw a plane very easily, which is there in these two directions? The YZ plane, at which the probability to find the electron is 0. Also, you can see the plane is passing through the nucleus. So this is the nucleus, plane passes through the nucleus, where there is no probability to find the electron. And hence only one kind of plane exists. So I will say option number A. So the number of nodal planes in the px orbital is just 1. So making it sure that option number A is the correct option for the given question. Okay. So guys, this was all about the 10 questions that I have collected for the NEET level exercise. Try to do the questions once by yourself also. Also, I'll ask you to try out certain other questions. If you'll be having doubts, please feel free to contact me so that I can help you out. So for my next lecture, you need to wait so that we can meet again and study further. Till that time, take care. Bye-bye.